Now, our third and final story on the ravages of the cross-border drug trade with Mexico. With the support of the Pulitzer Center, special correspondent Monica Villamizar and producer Zach Fannin travel to the mountaintop village of Ayahualtempa in Guerrero State, Mexico. They found children learning how to use firearms, preparing for an attack by a nearby cartel.
After Mexico's president, Andrés Manuel López Obrador, saw images like these of children as young as six learning how to shoot, he became enraged.
No se debe de utilizar a los niños.
Children should not be used like this. I am emphatic about that.
But despite the president's harsh reaction, the Nahua indigenous community are still preparing to defend themselves against a drug cartel known as Los Ardillos, or the squirrels. The children are part of what's called a community guard that's made up of 96 adult men and a dozen children who defend this village, Ayahualtempa, where 600 people live. Mexican law allows some indigenous communities to establish their own police forces.
So children over 12 can have real guns, but all of the very small ones have toy guns. And the reason is it gets them used to the idea that they have to defend themselves.
This self-defense group is filling the void left by the state. There are no armed Mexican security forces nearby to protect the besieged town.
There is no medical facility and no financial aid has been provided to these villagers so they can weather the crisis that has isolated them from the outside world.
After decades of growing poppy plants, the raw material for heroin, this impoverished agricultural community stopped growing the illegal crop in 2015. Cutting off all transactions with the local cartels and their intermediaries, fearing a takeover from the increasingly powerful and violent group. In November of 2019, as the cartel gained more power, the murder rate started steadily increasing. In the past few months, 9 people have been killed in this village, and 34 others were slain in surrounding towns. The villagers believe the violence is a deadly message from the cartel that wants to take over this drug corridor and tax local businesses as a form of extortion. Today, this picturesque town has still not been invaded and occupied by the cartel, but the security situation is so bad, locals can't travel to the nearby farmers market. The local school shut down because it sits in a cartel-controlled area just past this chain that serves as a demarcation barrier.
We, the farmers, our job is to work the land. But since there's no security, well, we feel obligated to take up arms, prepare the kids, because we don't know when or at what hour they're going to kill us. So if we don't prepare the kids, soon they won't be able to defend themselves. The advantage that we have is that we prepare the community police for each shot they take, so they don't miss, that we don't waste bullets because we don't have resources to purchase ammunition.
Every time the leader, Bernardino Sanchez, is out on patrol, his bodyguards follow him. 13-year-old Miguel is the youngest armed guard in the village. He says he misses school and splits his time between herding goats and weapons training, preparing for a possible cartel invasion.
They have attacked our families. They've kidnapped us. They've killed us. Since then, I've grabbed a weapon.
Do you think it's normal that a kid your age is armed and has a rifle?
No, pero lo uso para. No, but I use it to defend my village.
A los delincuentes.
This man, who preferred to keep his identity anonymous, says his brother, a community police commander, was murdered by the cartel. Afterwards, this community wrote a letter to the Mexican government asking for help, but it fell on deaf ears. Now he has a warning.
The government needs to listen. We are defending ourselves. Yes, not because we like to carry weapons or because we want to kill. So long as our enemies don't provoke us, all is okay. But if they provoke us, who knows what will happen to us? Yes, I know they will kill us, but they will also die, so that's all.
Citizens taking up arms to defend themselves from cartels is nothing new here in the states of Guerrero and neighboring Michoacán. The last civilian uprising in 2012 made the region one of the most volatile in the country. Writer Joan Grillo explains that the militia movement is complicated.
With this self-defense movement, you then had very different things that was outside of indigenous communities. It was just all kinds of groups of people creating armed squads. Some of them would are genuine and really defend their community. Some of them are mixed, like a bit dubious, like they might be defending the community, but they're a bit suspect people. And some of them are full-on drug trafficking organizations that are using the outer offender self-defense name to just to do their other activities.
With this new uprising well underway, it's unclear if local militias like this one will help decrease or increase Mexico's sky-high homicide rate of 34,000 murders last year, many of which were drug-related. And just over the border from Mexico in southern Arizona, these men are part of a training session given by the Arizona Border Recon. The group calls themselves an intelligence gathering operation, but they're armed to interdict and capture. Their leader is this man, Tim Foley.
We love our country. We've taken an oath. You know, most of us were in the military or law enforcement, and we took an oath to defend the country. And it doesn't end when you get out. It's a lifelong oath.
Tim Foley traveled to the Capitol on January 6th. Foley didn't enter the building, but says he doesn't think the violence was initiated by Trump supporters.
We were there, I would say, 45 minutes before Trump even ended his speech. And there were instigators already there harassing the police, and tear gas was already being shot. And I got gassed 5 times that day.
Bang, bang, bang. Bang, bang.
This training is preparing recon members for a hypothetical attack by smugglers illegally crossing into the U.S.
Do you guys train with live ammo?
No, it's a safety thing. We do carry rounds with us, and we do have sidearms that are loaded just in case.
Foley says he finances his militia through paid training and speaking engagements. The recon also conducts armed patrols using loaded AR-15s, pistols, and shotguns on one of the routes where drugs are smuggled on foot for the Sinaloa cartel. This militia patrols the area because they say the government has failed to. Groups of men crossing this public desert by foot with backpacks can be seen in footage that Foley captured on his hidden cameras. Foley calls them dope mules.
The dope mules nowadays, their packs are bigger, they're camouflaged, but every cubic centimeter in that pack is full. And basically it's fentanyl, meth, heroin, cocaine.
Foley's cameras caught this man with an automatic weapon. And just over the border inside Mexico, one of Foley's drones captured this man, pointing his gun at the camera. Foley believes he is a cartel lookout who feeds information to mules on foot. Foley says the recon is in the business of combating the cartel's delivery service.
Like any business, they have delivery schedules and everything else. So when we come out, what we do is we try to mess up their logistics. If we can get in front of them and deter them from coming in that way, and they have to move to go, say, 2 miles, but if we're sitting there also, then they have to move again. So they're burning up their food and logistics. So that way it makes it harder and harder for them, and they're not keeping their delivery schedule. So you're going to get some upset customers.
Foley has stopped groups that he believed were illegally crossing into the U.S. He says he gives the border crossers water and immediately notifies the Border Patrol. It's nonetheless an armed private citizen taking law enforcement duties. So far, he hasn't gotten into a shootout. Customs and Border Protection would like Foley and his men to stand down. They provided this written statement. CBP does not endorse or support any private group or organization from taking matters into their own hands, as it could have disastrous personal and public safety consequences.
They're already here.
Mark Napier was the elected Republican sheriff of Pima County, where Foley conducts his patrols from 2016 until last year.
What do you do?
Today, Napier works for the neighboring Cochise County Sheriff's Department.
How do you determine who a good guy and a bad guy is when people are carrying rifles and they're all cammied up? I'm not interested in armed militia out there playing soldier of fortune. I think that's problematic.
However, Sheriff David Hathaway, a Spanish-speaking elected Democrat of neighboring Santa Cruz County, points out that since Arizona is an open carry state, conducting training programs and patrols is not against the law.
You know, as sheriff in my position, as long as they're not violating the laws, as long as they're not
assaulting somebody, intimidating somebody, threatening somebody. You know, they are free to go on public lands. There's a lot of public government-owned land in Arizona.
Tim Foley says he's been called a racist, but he points out that members of the recon are Latino.
If we see somebody crossing, we'll just notify the Border Patrol.
Hugo owns a taxi service on the East Coast of the United States and spends his free time with the recon. He didn't want to tell us his last name due to fear of reprisals.
I was born in Uruguay, and I first came to this country as an exchange student. A few years later, I became a U.S. citizen.
Foley concedes more drug mules get around him than the recon can stop. But given the deadliness of fentanyl and other drugs, he is still dedicated to the pursuit.
The way I look at it, every little bit helps. That load I stopped might have saved two people. That load I stopped might have saved one. I can walk away, but I look in the mirror and go, what didn't we try to stop?
For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Monica Villamizar in Pima County, Arizona.